This podcast is going to be a little bit different. Not often do we cover a movie that we're pretty sure not all that many people have actually seen. So I hope that you'll take it in stride and give this a listen all the way through as we try to talk about a movie and maybe pitch it a little bit to you as something to stream or rent sometime. Maybe check out something a little bit different that was just overlooked at the time. And with that, let's get started. Hi, you've reached the Signal Watch. Film, comics, television, sci-fi, superheroes, noir, history, and more. Join us as we examine cultural artifacts of the 20th century, boldly explore the 21st, and try to put it all in perspective. As always, I'm your host, Ryan Steens. Stay tuned, we're gonna try to make this work. Hi everybody, we are back, and I am delighted to welcome back our very first co-host.
Hi!
Hi, Amy. So, it had been a little bit of time since you've been back to do the podcast, and we were, you know, we didn't even really kick around ideas for what to do. You just pitched an idea right out of the gate, and you pitched
Southland Tales.
Which I had never seen. I think for a brief history of the film, it was released in about 2006.
Six or seven, mm-hmm. I think, somewhere in there.
It had atrocious reviews.
Yep.
It, I think, got kind of panned at Cannes, if I remember correctly. If I'm wrong, you'll hear about it. And it was generally a big disappointment and disappeared into the ether. I did not see the movie at the time. Never saw it before, whatever, 2 hours ago. And the reason I didn't see it at the time was I did not understand from the trailer what it was. It looked like another, like, I thought it was going to be a post-apocalyptic movie about LA, which was not a topic that I gave two cents about in 2007. I noticed it had this huge sprawling cast. Kind of was like, whatever. Didn't actually know who the director was at the time. Had I known, that probably would have raised my interest. But you did see the movie, I guess, early on.
I saw it very early on, and I bought the graphic novels that, you know, helped one to get into it. And this is, quite frankly, one of my favorite movies.
And honestly, after having just watched it, I think we were about 30, 45 minutes into it, and I turned to Amy and said, "This is my new favorite movie." This movie is amazing. I can't believe that people don't talk about it. Yeah. And now, I also have very particular tastes. Maybe Amy and I share those tastes.
Yes.
But, yeah, and it's a movie I know that as I rewatch it, I'm going to be pulling things out of it for years to come as I watch it again and again. I probably won't watch it again for a few months.
Right.
But I do want to rewatch it. Now, I will also say, you mentioned the graphic novels just now.
Yes.
And for me, that was actually a huge turnoff when it was being marketed. I was just kind of like, oh, they're already trying to sell product. I don't know what this thing is. Kind of, why are they trying to burden me with $45 in graphic novel purchases so I can understand the movie, which is usually never the case if you're into doing the whole comics related to the movie business. Usually it's a more or less cash grab, but they had like three full graphic novels that you could read associated with the movie. And you've read them.
Yeah, and I read them at the time of release, so it was quite some time ago, and I do not claim to have a perfect recollection of them. But they did help the movie make more sense, and since you've now seen it, mm-hmm. you can see how information-dense it was.
It is one of the most information-dense movies I have any recollection of seeing.
Yes, and so having some printed material beforehand is actually really helpful.
Yeah, I do wonder if it would remove some of the mystery of the movie, some of the unpacking of the movie that you have to do and be really active as you're doing it. I was really glad I'd had two large cups of coffee while we were watching the movie to kind of just keep up with it. It moves incredibly fast. Every line has meaning to it. It's a narrative economy is running at like 150%.
Yes. Yes, there's a... should we give a brief sketch of what the movie is...
Go nuts.
...about? Should we attempt a brief sketch? All right, so it is a near future movie. It is set in an America where the Patriot Act that we know is on steroids, basically, and a kind of semi-governmental corporation has taken over the responsibility of tracking internet and cell phones and conversations in public places, and there's a lot of family ties that come into play with that, and there are celebrities with connections to the families that run this corporate political enterprise, and some stuff happens, some other things happen. It's actually really hard to summarize except for to say that it's not that far off from our current reality, but when it was released, it seemed far-fetched.
Right. I made the comparison to, and don't take this the wrong way, if it's been a while since you've seen RoboCop, if the last time you saw it was when you were like 12, rewatch RoboCop. It's very clearly intended to be a satire, which at the time, people didn't take the satire that seriously because, oh, you know, whatever, this all seemed very far-fetched. Now when you watch RoboCop, it almost seems quaint. And you mentioned a few other movies that were satires that you thought would make excellent co-programming with this movie.
Yes. If I were to be setting up a movie marathon, of which Southland Tales was a part, I would also show it alongside Starship Troopers and Josie and the Pussycats. And yes, I said both of those things.
Yeah, if you've never seen Josie and the Pussycats, it's hilarious, and it's really, it is not what you think it is going to be going into the movie.
Yeah.
And Starship Troopers, I think, has had a lot more traction over the years as far as basic cable and kind of rentals, and people kind of know about Starship Troopers and kind of the militarization satire. But I watched it again recently, and yeah, that is another movie that's kind of every scene, every line has reflections back to our current reality that... reality finally caught up with the satire.
Yes.
Reality may have gotten weirder than the satire at this point.
Yep. One of the plot points in Southland Tales that we were talking about earlier, and I think it bears sharing, is one of the many, many subplots is that there is a porn star dating a person who's attached to a political dynasty. And obviously that closely maps upon our current day political situation where there's a porn star who theoretically could have brought down the presidency and may still, depending on how that shakes out. I don't know. But the fact that in the movie everyone's reacting like, oh, porn star, this is terrible. Oh, there's an affair in the family of this politician. Woo, woo. It's like, it's adorable right now. You're like, oh, that's so precious. merely an affair with a porn star. That's so cute. But who could have anticipated this in 2007?
Yeah, it's as far as science fiction goes, it is a science fiction film.
Yes.
But it's deeply rooted in the American political climate and someone kind of prognosticating against what was going on and kind of worst case scenario. When I say satire, it is not just a satire of conservatism. If that's how you bend and you get mad when you think it's only, you know, those dirty liberals picking on the conservatives, I think it does a fairly good job of also satirizing and kind of lampooning what's going on with what goes on with the left and kind of how they operate. Kind of to their own detriment quite a bit.
Yep.
The cast, I want to get right into the cast because it's, since honestly the player, was it Prêt-à-Porter? Is that the one that has like 1,000 people at the fashion show?
I think so.
Yeah. I can't, aside from really Altman movies, it's hard to think of a movie that is more celebrity dense or more familiar face dense. And I'm, now some of these people are kind of the cream of the crop. they weren't necessarily at the time. It was like they were like, how many people can we get for our actor budget? We're not going to cast Schwarzenegger or whomever was hot in 2006. I don't remember anymore. And so instead, they just spread the money around and got all these familiar faces and pulled them in. And it's everybody from The Rock, mm-hmm. who was looks like a baby in this movie, as
an
you said.
Infant. A little baby Rock.
And it may be Zelda Rubinstein's last movie. So anyway, go ahead and talk. I'm going nuts because I just saw this movie and my brain is just firing.
It's got John Larroquette in it. It's also got Sarah Michelle Gellar. Mm-hmm. It's got Bai Ling. It's got...
John Lovitz?
Yes, John Lovitz Nora is Dunn. A badass, hard-bitten cop, which mm-hmm. is weird. It's got Sherry O'Terry, mm-hmm. who's just a boss-ass bitch in it. And I say that with great affection and respect, but she's just like, I want to just kill everybody. You know, I can't believe these stupid people around me. Mm-hmm. Sherry O'Terry. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's real strange when you think about it. Mm-hmm. And Rebecca Del Rio does a musical number in it, which is, quite frankly, one of my favorite musical performances ever committed to film.
That's like number three of my delight. Yes. It's she if you don't know Rebecca Del Rio, you might remember her from Mulholland Drive in Club Silencio, and then she popped up in season 3 of Twin Peaks as well.
And she does the Star Spangled Banner in English and Spanish. The thing that was just killing me was that it was a performance on a Zeppelin for a bunch of Republicans, and it was bilingual. There's just a lot going on.
Yeah, they don't shy away from some of the political inconsistencies, I guess, work for both the left and the right in this movie.
Yes, and I think that it's worth mentioning a little bit about the scene dressing for the neo-Marxist, which were, you know, very obviously intended to stand in direct opposition to the Republican fascists mm-hmm. that are controlling all these systems of surveillance. There were two kind of recurring themes in the neo-Marxist decor, and it was toilets and heads.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know what that's about, but
I'm still not clear on what was going on with them needing digits too, and by digits I mean fingers.
Right. I think it was some form of voter fraud, but long story short, there are a lot of fingers that were displayed in coolers, kind of casually on counters. Mm-hmm. There's a particularly interesting scene where the Prime Minister of Japan mm-hmm. got most of his hand cut off and then proceeded to screamingly kind of try to renegotiate the contract whereby his finger was cut off. But the Baron character, who's the developer of this alternate energy, was like, we have a margin of error plus or minus 6 inches.
Yeah, he's gone Six Sigma with his,
I guess your people didn't read the contract.
And I want to mention, that's Wallace Shawn, of all people. Like, Wallace Shawn is dropped, you know, Mr. My Dinner with Andre, Princess Bride, is in the middle of all of this, having the time of his life as this kind of mad scientist mm-hmm. Who it may be playing both sides of what's going on, which is part of why I was trying to figure out, because I was like, now he wants those digits, and he seems to be funding whatever's going on with the Marxists who are collecting digits. And anyway, I kept expecting something to come up with hands later on in the movie. I'll be honest, spoiler, nothing happens.
Not a goddamn thing. I'm gonna share a piece of color commentary.
Well, that's not true, though.
Well, okay. What do you think happens? Tell me what happens.
I don't know. But okay. I do know that handshakes are very important to the movie.
That is true, and so are souls. Mm-hmm. So all of that does come into play. But I'd like to share a little bit of commentary about the Baron character for a moment.
Go nuts.
And this doesn't have anything to do with the plot, but it's just something that makes me laugh. it occurred to me today that the Baron and Serpentine, his his companion, played by Bai Ling, I kept on imagining them as Elon Musk and Grimes.
Oh my God.
Just the entire time.
Yeah. And the funny thing is, this is all about this, like, just to give you guys an idea, and I don't want to spoil the movie, but I really want you to see it. And even if we told the entire plot, it wouldn't really spoil it.
We cannot tell the entire plot.
But there's all this stuff about, like, an alternate timeline in one reality versus another. And I thought the suggestion was that they would somehow gone into our reality, and this movie took place in the other reality. And so now I'm creeped out.
Elon Musk and Grimes. I'm telling you now.
Oh my God. There's also this interesting thing of there's kind of three women, and that's his mother, and then Zelda Rubinstein, who they never quite say where she's from. And then I think it was, I don't remember who the third woman was. Anyway, but that kind of gave me this, like, Nordic mythology, like, oh, it's the three fates, you know, kind of always gathering together. And they kind of start giving The Rock his fate, his boxer character, what his fate is going to be. So.
Boxer Santaros getting weird Judeo-Christian prophecy from the Norns. That makes sense. That checks out.
It's like if you took everything off your bookshelf and put it into a blender and tried to glue it all back together into a narrative somehow. That's kind of Southland Tales. And I'm trying to figure out why other people didn't like this. I mean, I know, like, I couldn't show this movie to my mom and expect her to be like, oh yeah, that was a good time at the cinema. But I'm a little surprised it did poorly as far as with reviewers. Maybe the references in it. It has dense referencing to Jane's Addiction's 3 Days.
Yep. It's like Revelations and also Perry for All and then pretty much the entire cast of Mad TV and Saturday Night Live. What's not to love?
Right. It's like if you're in your mid-40s, this movie was aimed directly at you. If you missed it, I'm very sorry. You know, if you were of a certain media consumption bent in the, you know, 80s, 90s, and aughts, this movie was kind of really aimed directly at you. And I'm sorry you missed it. If you, like myself, you didn't see it until today. So stop this podcast now. It's on Amazon Prime streaming. Go watch it. Mm-hmm. And then come right back and pick up right here with what Amy's about to tell you.
There's so much to say that wouldn't even spoil it. I don't really think there's even the possibility of truly spoiling this movie because it's so... Mm-hmm. It's hard to explain what's happening. You can't give a one sentence summary. That's
Oh God, no. I mean, there's this kind of scheme that the neo-Marxists are trying to do to try to blackmail the conservatives that blows up in their face because there's double dealing within the neo-Marxists plus whatever's going on with Boxer Santero, who is married to Mandy Moore.
Yeah. This movie. The person played by Mandy Moore. We obviously did a lot of deep research on this. Yeah, it's
his mother is played by Miranda Richardson.
Everything is weird.
Who is, you know, and it would have seemed a little bit absurd in 2006 to have had a political appointee be another strong politician's spouse, but right now the head of the transportation department is Mitch McConnell's wife. The kind of just absolute craziness that starts happening once you get into this kind of total government dominant control from either party. You know, the kind of back dealing and things that would have seemed improprietous in a, you know, more pure environment or an environment where someone was at least able to use their clout to call people out and take people down is very much on parade in this movie as kind of, oh, it's absurd, but, you know, that's how this works in this movie. And of course, here we are in very short order, you know, 10 years later, looking at exactly the same thing.
Yes. You know, it's really interesting how we have these, the possibility of parallel timelines or of divergent timelines that are manufactured in the current moment in this film. And there's always this, when I read things nowadays, as I read the news, I always think about the multiverse theory, right? And there's a lot of jokes that people make now about the darkest timeline, mm-hmm. which is, you know, really a joke that comes from Community, the series. And for people who aren't familiar with that, go watch it now. Stop ruining your own life. but this feels strangely prescient.
Uh-huh.
Because of the fact that we seem to have found ourselves on one of the more absurd possible timelines.
Yeah, I mean, it was predicted in Simpsons as the thing that was so absurd it couldn't possibly happen.
No, haha, President Trump. Whoops.
Right. And I don't really care if you like President Trump and you're listening to this podcast. Tough nuts. You know, we always try and be nice and polite on this podcast, but it's a theater of the absurd right now, and it's absolutely crazy the things that we consider to be satire that all right-thinking Americans would have believed to have been too far along that have gotten pushed into reality, and reflecting back on that via a movie like this is a little chilling.
Right. And one of the parts of the viewing experience for this is that there are often screens full of screens. And so you see at various points, you see a sniper's screen. I say sniper, and what I really mean is a surveillance officer / sniper, which is very hard to say for someone with a slight inherent lisp. But I think I said it.
Hey, high five on people with slight inherent lisps.
Yeah. But you see that, and you see these monitoring agency screens, and then you see the news screens that people are absorbing their daily news from, and you have like all these different views of screens on your screen as you're watching the movie, which is, at the time, was pretty gosh darn meta. Mm-hmm. You didn't really see that very often. I think it's become a little bit more common now to have these kind of mixed digital media views within films, but at the time that was fairly unusual.
Yeah, I think its predecessors, I would definitely point to the comic book of Dark Knight Returns that does all of the different, you know, as if you're flipping channels while, you know, something's going on in the Batman's world. And then if you go back to Starship Troopers, there's this whole like learn more thing that's right. going on as you're watching, which, you know, was kind of based on web concepts of the time. And I was a little shocked when I recently rewatched it to see how prescient that was. And then this came up with all the ads in the sidebar, which they'd somehow gotten Hustler in there. Hustler makes a lot of appearances as a sponsor in this movie, which is hysterical.
Yep. That and Budweiser. It's like yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to think of kind of the timeline as far as our reality goes, our actual reality. But there's a talk show and kind of multimedia packaging deal that Krista now is trying to put together. She's got a fashion line and sports drink, and she's going to have her talk show where it's her and three other porn stars talking about the events of the day, and she's going to become this global phenomenon. And that was happening for sure back then, and people were like really crass about it. I do remember that. I think people try and keep a little bit of that under wraps now as they're developing their business plans, because most, you know, 9 out of 10 parts of those plans end up fizzling. So if you come out and immediately say, we're going to sell, you know, high-end fashion and an energy drink, everyone's like, I don't understand what your plan is. But I thought the media presence and kind of how things were talked about definitely have a deep reflection in kind of how a lot of media is handled these days.
Yes, and I think it's important to note, if you haven't watched the movie, Krista Now is played by Sarah Michelle Gellar, who has not really been on screen that often except for as Buffy or as a character in Scooby-Doo, in the live-action Scooby-Doo films. It's really interesting because she is pretty unapologetically what she is. She doesn't try to pretend that she's doing anything other than being a porn star that also has a diversified line of offerings, which was a kind of interesting position to have in 2007 or so, or 2006, whenever. It's I'm trying to think of who would be a close parallel today, and I think that Sasha Grey might. Not to, you know, show off my knowledge of porn stars too much, but just like, you know, there are a few since the early 2000s that have kind of made some moves towards a broader cultural relevance, and it's interesting to see that. And I, for the record, I would totally watch a talk show with porn stars talking about the issues of the day.
Well, I think we all would.
I would be very accepting of that. I would encourage that. I would enjoy that. And I guess, you know, to a certain extent, there's podcasts and, you know, Tumblr vids and all that kind of stuff where that happens. But it's just like, it seems valid.
There's a great scene in the movie, not to just get into the, that was awesome, you know, part of the podcast. But there's a great part when Mandy Moore's character, who is in a rage because her husband has been apparently shacking up with Kristen now, she demands Kristen now be brought before her, and it's all men in the room aside from her.
Yes.
And they're handing around her CD, which includes the title track, Teen Horniness Is Not a Crime.
Yep.
It's about to go down.
Go down.
Right now.
Right now.
Right now.
Right now.
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 Now. Right now.
Right now.
Miss Kristen now.
Open your heart and your mind. Horniness is on the rise. Look inside and you will find horniness is not a crime.
Every time they keep saying we shouldn't. Every time Mandy Moore is appealing to their reason, we shouldn't be listening to this person. You just keep seeing them look at the album cover and go, but
yeah. She wasn't getting a lot of traction in her argument against her. That is true.
Yeah, it really slides between being absolutely hysterical. Some parts are very poignant, and then in the middle of a scene when they're being completely poignant, then suddenly there's a line drop that's totally hysterical, and it doesn't take the wind out of the scene.
Not at all.
It'll really drive it home. It's a really weird balancing act. I do wonder when this movie played at like Cannes and some other places if it was in. I'm probably blowing some smoke here, but was it too American for an international audience that may think of the U.S. as being much more, as everybody does when you think of another nation, being kind of one more blob or one hive mind of, oh, the French do this, the Germans do that, and to see kind of, here's kind of what's actually happening in the U.S. in a way that's recognizable to Americans, that's not sanitized for TV or movies or oversimplified for TV or movies. And it doesn't really matter how much you read the paper or how much you try and understand via the media, what's actually happening in on-the-ground conversations feels a lot different often from what's playing out there, or even on Twitter or other places.
Yes, I think that it probably was ahead of its time in just too many ways to be palatable. And one of the things that I think may have set people's teeth against it pretty early on is the fact that it starts out with what appears to be, you know, a handheld camera shot footage of a Texas barbecue for the 4th of July, which is a total departure from the entire rest of the film. Like, there's nothing else quite like that that's happening anywhere else in the film. But, you know, in that particular era, if you think about how the planet felt about the United States at that time, we were, you know, knee-deep in various wars that were started by someone who was perceived as a Texan president, even though he was totally from Connecticut. You know, that was probably not... tonally, that was probably hard to take.
Yeah, just so you know, the movie starts off with nuclear detonations in Abilene, and I'm trying to remember what the other city was. But so if you don't know Texas, Abilene is a fairly small city, probably about 2 hours northwest of Austin. Yeah, Abilene's an interesting town. Sounds. I thought it was an interesting place for, and it, you know, it's kind of middle America in a lot of ways. And so it was an interesting strike point for them to pick. Plus, by the way, Justin Timberlake is a character in this movie.
Right.
He's a pitbull character. Name, yeah, his last name is Abilene, if I remember correctly.
Yeah.
And I never quite got what the connection was there, or if... Yeah.
You didn't see that, but I shrugged real big.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's often the voice of God, revealed via prophecy... Does a lot of quotes from Revelations throughout the film.
The conservative Texas senator quotes Robert Frost frequently. Weird Witches quote Jane's Addiction.
Yep.
And he's quoting Revelations.
Quite a lot.
To give you an idea of how this movie goes down.
Yeah. Yeah. That's Frost, Jane's Addiction, and straight up Revelation of St. John the Divine account for probably a good 30% of the total dialogue. Just so you know.
I don't know. I think when we're at this point, we're trying to sell people on watching the movie. What else can we tell them about it? You did talk a little bit when we were watching the movie about, I suspect, you talked about the look and feel of the movie.
Yes.
And I suspect it was shot on the brand new digital cinema cameras of the era. Which had been used on Superman Returns at about the same time, and that was a really big deal that they were doing that. If it wasn't shot on that, I can't really account for the kind of strange look of the film other than maybe in post-processing. There are some scenes where there's clearly digital effects going on, but overall, you're right, it had a certain grayness and flatness to it.
It did. It had the feeling of reality mediated through a screen, mm-hmm. for sure. And the fact that technology was just emerging makes it more likely that that's what was happening. And I was talking about the look and feel in regards to what I think the heritage was. I think that Kelly was definitely pulling from David Lynch as far as the kind of portentous or dialogue where it's like, you know, I'm going to speak prophecy as opposed to say things that a normal human would say. Mm-hmm. And then I think there was a certain Kubrickian chill to a lot of it, and there were a lot of side details that if you hit the pause button like every 10 seconds and studied what was on the screen, you would see just a massive amount of information. Mm-hmm. It's not the best experience from a narrative perspective to do that, but you could do that from a design perspective. And I think that Kubrick has a similar density of information that's often layered through the set dressing.
Yeah, absolutely. And I don't know if, given the density of the plot on top of that, that may have been just too much for, you know, a afternoon viewing at a film festival and what movie reviewers are having to put up with. Cutting in real fast, I did a little bit of research. There's an article, I believe, from Vice from a couple of years ago where one of their reporters interviews director Richard Kelly about the film, and he talks in length about the experience at Cannes and what occurred. The actual screenings occurred with a press screening at 9 in the morning and a much later screening that was the Black Tie Affair. Probably a little moot if I'm a little obsessed with what happened at Cannes. I find it fascinating that veteran auteurs there get standing ovations for highly dense or impenetrable films. And this guy who was 30 years old, who had done something pretty extraordinary, had really taken it on the chin. I didn't find anything about what kind of cameras were used. I did a little bit of digging there. It's probably out there. And if I find anything else out, I will link to it on the SoundCloud. when we talked briefly after the movie, I was totally on board with the Lynch thing. I think I get what you're saying with the Kubrickian thing. I think it is one of those movies where people are saying things, but if you take it as dialogue, as two people having a conversation, 9 out of 10 of those, you're absolutely right. There's something else, completely else going on with what they're saying, and it takes kind of parsing that back to figure out what the meaning is of what that is within the context and framing of the film versus a friendly romantic comedy where people are saying what they mean, or a Marvel movie where they're doubling down to make sure every last dummy in the theater got what's happening in this kind of crazy world.
Yeah.
There's some interesting musical selections as well. I mean, Rebecca Del Rio, not least among them. Jane's Addiction plays a key part. I hope that your 90s went as well as mine did, and you understood those references. Any other songs you wanted to pull out and talk about?
Well, one of my all-time favorite music videos is a hallucination that Justin Timberlake's character, Pilot Abilene, is having in a game arcade after shooting himself up with an alternative energy source that is also a drug called Liquid Karma. He injects it into his neck and proceeds to fall into a video for the Killers, All These Things That I've Done, which is the I've Got Soul But I'm Not a Soldier mm-hmm. song. He hallucinates himself in a bloody t-shirt and drinking an apparently unending supply of beer, canned beer specifically, while naughty nurses cavort around him in an arcade. I love it so much. I don't understand why. I don't understand why it's there. I don't understand anything about what's happening, but that is one of my favorite things I've ever seen in my life. And it's kind of the high point of the film as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, it's a movie that has kind of musical numbers like that. Between that and Rebecca Del Rio, and there is the movie kind of ends, I don't want to give it away too much, but with a dance sequence.
That's fair. Yeah, that's a fair summary.
Which has narrative meaning as you're watching the dance sequence. Okay. It doesn't exactly get into, dream sequence and Broadway melody from Singing in the Rain, but it's nonetheless, The Rock is up there with Sarah Michelle Gellar and Mandy Moore, and there's, they're dancing out what is happening with them interpersonally.
Yeah.
Sean William Scott is in the movie.
He is.
Twice.
That's fair.
He plays twin brothers.
Yep, who may not actually be brothers in the sense that we understand it.
Right, Roland and Ronald. And I do feel a little bad for both he and Sarah Michelle Gellar on the heels of this movie. I felt like Sarah Michelle Gellar kind of took it on the chin from this movie, whether people had seen it or not. Somehow saying she couldn't carry like a sci-fi summer movie or whatever. And I wouldn't say it's quite the same for him, but he's actually pretty good in this movie.
Yeah, they're both great. They're both exactly doing what they're supposed to do. It's just I don't think people understood what they were supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
And Sean William Scott shows a great deal of emotional range in this film. Mm-hmm. That is not necessarily a trait I would associate with his brand as an actor.
Yeah, he's Stifler. He's Dude, Where's My Car?
Right.
He was in that one movie with Chow Yun-Fat where he was playing the dopey guy hanging out with the cool martial artist. And now I don't know where he is. He could be anywhere.
Yeah, I don't know what he's been up to, but I can say that he played a traumatized vet who may or may not have been cloned through a space-time anomaly. He did a great job.
If that's your character arc, that's how you do it.
Yeah. No, he was not just like this grinning buffoon that I think we kind of associate with him as an actor.
Mm-hmm.
He was tortured. He was troubled. He had moments where he couldn't figure out what was going on, and he kind of just shut down and tried to try to move through the necessary actions to continue to be alive, which is great. Thinking about this movie, I think that for so many people, it was so far off their brand
mm-hmm.
that people could not process this person doing something so radically different than what they usually do. John Lovitz being another example of this.
Oh, yeah.
What the hell? John Lovitz as badass murderous cop?
Yeah.
What? That makes no sense.
Yeah. It gave him a huge opportunity, and he totally nailed it.
He did. He was scary. Mm-hmm. You're just like, wow, that's... You know, normally you think about him as the kind of guy who would send soup back three times, and that's...
Yeah. Yeah, Sherry O'Terry, I mean, I was not surprised when I saw, you know, I hadn't figured out where she was, and she was, like, playing a teacher on, like, a Disney show or something like that. Not everybody ends up kind of having these careers that kind of keep spiraling upward and upward and upward. You know, they end up just, they keep working, and that's not a small thing in Hollywood. And I would never, ever say anyone who you continue to see on screen isn't totally kicking ass, because that's the hardest gig there is out there.
Yeah.
Or anywhere. But it's a tough job. And I know John Lovitz has not always gotten the opportunities he had, and I'm sure all these people were like, yeah, I get a chance to show my range, and then no one liked the movie, no one showed up for it, you know, and it was what it was. So we're here to tell you to watch the movie.
Yep. Watch the movie. Watch Southland Tales.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of anything to compare it to, not just from the satirical standpoint, but something that's that dense. And short of the actual graphic novel of Watchmen, it's kind of hard for me to pull something out. But, you know, as far as like the graphic novel, maybe that has the same level of density, which I've heard compared to Thomas Pynchon, who I've never read. So I have to just throw my hands in the air and say, I don't read big, thick books. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tricky. We were talking earlier, and I said something about how the casting must have been just like flipping through channels late at night. Like, oh, Buffy the Vampire Slayer's in a rerun. Let's get her. Oh, Night Court's in a rerun. Let's get John Larroquette. Oh, here's some Saturday Night Live. Let's get a couple of people from that. Oh, Mad TV is on. It's just click, click, click.
Will Sasso's in the movie.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Will Sasso is in it, and Amy Poehler's in it.
Amy Poehler's in
which
it.
Which is hilarious. You know, it's such a strange mixture of people and influences and narrative devices. It's really, it feels like you've been up too late and you're watching TV and you're flipping around, and sometimes you watch something for a few minutes while you're also looking at your laptop. You know?
You're taking in the news while you're also taking in the sci-fi movie, right?
And you're very tired.
Yes.
It all sort of makes sense, but it's hard to articulate why.
I compared it to Avengers Infinity War as far as of actors. Of you're taking all these people from, you know, kind of different genres and kind of blending them together in these different storylines that all have a kind of main through line together. You mentioned the imagery in the neo-Marxists. There's also some imagery of nuclear mushroom clouds,
yes,
which starts off the movie with the thing happening in Abilene. And then they cut to, within a scene or two, Sherry O'Terry watching Kiss Me Deadly, which is a noir movie that actually ends with a suitcase bomb. They actually show the ending of that movie completely unrelated 2 hours later in the movie. Which, you know, no connection if you don't know Kiss Me Deadly. But if you do, you're like, oh, it's Mickey Spillane, Kiss Me Deadly, Cloris Leachman's first appearance ever on film. I kept waiting to see a little bit more connection with Kiss Me Deadly, but that was me just being a Kiss Me Deadly fan. So.
Well, and I think there's just a lot of... There's so many concepts that are introduced, and then you're like, wow, that's neat. And then some of them reappear, or some of them come to a culmination, and others just sort of fall by the wayside. Mm-hmm. And if this was, I think this was intended to be more.
Oh, I am sure they intended to do multiple movies from this.
And so I kind of, you find yourself wondering what could have been if this had been received differently, or if someone just incredibly wealthy had decided to finance part two, or if they had kind of done maybe the Evil Dead, Evil Dead 2 approach, you know, where it's kind of remake a little bit and expand it, make it better. You know, like, it's hard to say. But I think of this as a really glorious folly in the kind of almost Victorian sense, where someone just had, like, this vision, and they had the resources to at least start the vision, and it could have been more... But it didn't have to be. Mm-hmm. It's great as it is.
Yeah.
In a very particular way.
had people more taken to it, I think it would be great fodder for like a Netflix series or an Amazon Prime series to kind of extend out some of these narratives and tease them out in ways that a mass audience could more easily consume and appreciate. And I'm not saying like Amy and I are these geniuses who... I will say Amy is also the same person who was like, you should pick up that Invisibles comic. I think that's going to be good, back in like whatever it was, fall of 93 or whatever. getting me into the sci-fi densely narrated books. But yeah, it's a really cool movie, and I'm really sorry I missed it on the first go round. We, you know, after seeing something like The Meg, that's, as we say, good, dumb summer fun, it's great to be able to turn around and see something like this that was kind of this gem. I knew you weren't going to make me watch garbage that I know I'm going to watch again and again. So,
aw, I'm so glad. I watch this at least once a year. Like, this is my 4th of July movie.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So I usually watch this in Team America World Police on the 4th of July.
It's its own form of patriotism. I can see that.
Skeptical patriotism.
Yeah.
Which is the kind I'm most comfortable with.
Yes. The Founding Fathers would probably not approve, but approve. Yeah. Okay. Depending on which one you're talking about. Well, with that, I don't know if there's anything else to cover.
I feel like this movie is a great movie for the kind of person who's comfortable with ambiguity. And if that describes someone that's listening, then please watch it, and we can talk about it after you've seen it.
Right. As I've been doing lately, I will tell you if you have comments or questions to drop them in the SoundCloud, or please come to the blog at signal-watch.com, that's signal-watch.com, and drop something in the comments there. We'd love to hear from you. If you've seen this, if you're angry about it, if you have a differing opinion, or if you run off and watch this, and thanks to this podcast, we want to hear about that too. But that's about it. So thank you so much, Amy. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Y'all have a great one. That about wraps it up for this edition of The Signal Watch, a production of the League of Melbotus. I've been your host, Ryan Steens. Thanks for sticking with us. We'll be back soon with more exceedingly high-quality content. So until next time, God damn it, babies, you've got to be kind.